Hello, you absolute legends. Mario Kart 64 was released in Japan in December of 1996, so we are 2 months away from celebrating the game's 25th birthday. And as someone who played it when it first came out, that makes me feel extremely old. But despite its age, we are still consistently learning new things about the way the game works. If you've ever seen Mario Kart 64 speedrunning, you'd know that some of the shortcuts players use are pretty bizarre, and as time goes on, more and more levels are being broken apart. Back in November of last year, I released a video describing a recent strategy that involved clipping through a fence in Kalimari Desert. This clip was so precise, the odds of getting it to work were 1 in 90,000. I also spoke of the devastating instance of a player actually getting the clip to work, but then immediately resetting the level due to muscle memory. For sure, one of the worst chokes I've ever seen. Since that video was released, only a single other player, known as Dossi, has ever successfully made that clip, going on to set a new world record in the process. Sometimes strategies are so unreliable that when someone actually does pull it off once, everyone else just stops trying. The pain of grinding such a ridiculous strategy just isn't worth the potential payoff if you're not the first to do it. The fence clip on Kalimari Desert was a terrible, monotonous, boring strategy. And honestly, who knows how long it would have been before someone else successfully made it work. As fate would have it, we will never find out. In the last 2 weeks, Kalimari Desert has been utterly destroyed by a brand new strategy that is both faster and much easier. On the surface, this new strategy doesn't seem too complex or outrageous, and we've seen similar-looking glitches used on other tracks for many years. But there is much more to this particular trick than meets the eye, and there's a reason it took 25 years to find it. In this video, we will take a look at this brand new technique that has blown apart Kalimari Desert, making redundant one of the worst strategies the game has ever had, and replacing it with something far more tolerable. I hope you enjoy. Now, before we go on, a big thank you to this video sponsor, Bespoke Post. Bespoke is a monthly membership club which delivers boxes containing a wide selection of really interesting and useful products. Every month, they will send you something new, and their lineup is constantly changing, so there will always be new things to try. Before your box is shipped, you can preview it and decide if you want to keep it, swap it for something else, or skip the month entirely for no charge. You only ever pay for the items you actually want, and you can cancel at any time. I received the Weekender bag, which ended up being really convenient because I'm literally going on holiday in a couple of days, and this bag is really nice. But I have to be honest, what I'm extremely excited about is the stealth box. Still, to this day, I do not have a nice knife to use around the house, and this looks fantastic, so I'm definitely going to be ordering this one. Every box has around $70 in retail value, but only costs $45. And if you want 20% off your first box, just go to the link in the description and enter KyleJobs20 at checkout. Again, just click the link in the description. Mario Kart 64 is pretty well known for hosting some crazy glitches and skips, but when it comes to the track Kalimari Desert, it's always been pretty rock solid. For almost its entire history, there were no major exploits or strategies that seemed to break the level. If you look at the course layout, it's extremely basic. The only thing that makes it somewhat interesting is the train line that dissects a portion of the track at two locations. The only shortcut that existed until 2020 was a jump over the train line, which enabled players to cut inside, minimizing the distance traveled. But this really didn't save much time. The non-shortcut world record is 2 minutes and 3 seconds, and until only recently, even in 2021, the shortcut record was only 2 seconds faster. But of course, things got massively shaken up in October of 2020, when a new fence clip was discovered by the Tasser Forest 64. This new clip would essentially allow players to skip half of the map by driving through the train line tunnel that carved through the central mountain. There was just one problem. This new clip was extremely precise. It required precision down to the level that is far beyond human perception. We are talking floating point precision, but that name doesn't really do it justice. Ultimately, the odds of performing this trick were around 1 in 90,000. Going for a trick with these odds is a pretty daunting task, and naturally, not many people took it seriously. One player did manage to win the proverbial lottery though, with Mr. Pitt managing to get through on the 8th of November. Unfortunately, due to muscle memory, he immediately paused afterwards, instantly invalidating the run. This was a crushing choke, one of the worst ever for sure. It did show that the fence clip was possible, but realistically, this was probably just a fluke. No one would be able to repeat Mr. Pitt's feat for almost half a year. The Australian runner Dossie would be the one to do so, nailing the clip on the 27th of April 2021. Dossie finished the three laps and closed out the race with a time that beat the existing world record by over 16 seconds, and that's where the story basically ended. Once this clip was used to smash the record once, most people's motivation seemed to dry up. It's one thing to be the first person to clutch a new strategy, but once the dam has been broken, the prestige gets lowered dramatically. No one has repeated the clip since Dossie's record, and that will probably remain the case for the rest of time. The Kalahari Desert fence clip will go down in history as one of the worst strategies ever. It's literally bashing your head against a wall for hours until something randomly happens. But thankfully, its reign of terror was relatively short-lived. In September of 2021, the strategic mastermind Forrest 64, the same person that unleashed hell with the fence clip in the first place, returned to save the day, this time bringing with him a brand new strategy. It was much faster and much easier, changing the way the level would be played forever. The seed for this new development was planted all the way back in 2008 with a tool-assisted speedrun built by Xenos. This one's a bit different because it's performed in Grand Prix rather than time trials, which means there are items and other players involved. The TAS uses three different exploits: a star inside the tunnel, a shell to get over the fence, and a large jump off of another player. Understanding the first and third of these tricks will help us understand this new strategy, so let's take a look. First, using a star in the tunnel to finish a lap early. This was actually an intended Easter egg, where if you drove through the tunnel with a star activated, you could complete a lap. So what's special about the star? Normally in Mario Kart 64, the finish line basically extends forever, which is why you'll often see speedrunners finish the race off to the side, as it ends up being a straighter line to the finish. This doesn't mean you can finish anywhere, though. When you progress a certain amount of distance along a course, the finish line deactivates. The tunnel inside of Kalahari Desert isn't far enough along the course for the finish line to automatically deactivate, so the developers did something they don't do on other tracks, which is to intentionally stop the finish line from extending indefinitely. The finish line basically stops at the wall of mountains just to the left. However, when the player activates a star, the finish line does extend forever. This isn't some byproduct of a pre-existing mechanic, this is literally something the designers of the game did as a secret shortcut. There is also one other aspect of the finish line we need to understand before this strategy makes sense. The way the game counts laps is extremely rudimentary. When you cross the finish line in the correct direction, the internal lap counter increases by 1. When you cross it going in the opposite direction, it decreases by 1. So if you were to sit at the starting line going back and forth, the internal lap value would just oscillate between negative 1 and 0. In order to get the lap value to increase further, you need to find a way to get back behind the finish line again without crossing it. Obviously, this is done normally by driving around the track, but there are other ways one can achieve the same goal. This is where shortcuts thrive. A really great example of a very illustrative shortcut is the one used on Wario's Stadium. Players will immediately jump over the wall to the left and circle around behind the finish line. While we don't get far away from the finish line in terms of distance, we are progressed enough along the track so that the finish line unloads. You can see here that the track is black. This means that particular section is unloaded, and you can see that it becomes loaded when our cart is above it. When this section of the track is loaded, the section containing the starting line is unloaded and the finish line deactivates. We can then circle around behind the finish line and jump back over the wall. Again, you can actually see that the track containing the finish line is unloaded until our cart is directly above that section. Once the finish line loads again and we cross it, the lap counter increases by 1. Repeat this process 3 times, and the lap counter increases up to a value of 3, which completes the race. Let's go back to Kalimuri Desert. By going through the tunnel, we can quickly get behind the finish line if we were to imagine it extending out indefinitely. We then activate the star, which extends the line so that we can cross it and increase the lap counter by 1. This is the exact strategy that the current All Cups World Record uses. Here, Beck Abney activates the star, crosses the line to finish the lap, and then goes out the way he came to continue the race. The TAS is going to do things a bit differently. Instead of going back out the tunnel the way they came, they're going to jump the fence near the finish line. At this point, we have a bit of a problem though. Given that the star is still active, we just can't turn around and continue through the tunnel. If we cross the finish line again going in the opposite direction, we will just lower the lap counter. Therefore, we have 2 options: waiting for the star animation to finish, or if possible, stopping the star animation early. Cancelling the animation early is possible by getting the cart into a tumbling state. This method is used by players to get rid of stars quickly when they are looking for a different item. The TAS initiates a tumble by driving into the wall, but because it's flat ground, they can do it in a very precise way, which does technically cause a tumble, but the tumbling animation itself gets cancelled immediately. Now that the star is no longer active, they can turn around and continue back through the tunnel, as when the star animation ended, the finish line no longer extended this far. The second trick implemented, which is a fence jump using a green shell, isn't important to this video, so we'll skip the explanation for this one. However, the third trick is very relevant. After crossing the finish line for the second time, we are now on lap 3. All we need to do is cross it a single time to finish the race. Before we got here, we quickly picked up an item which gave us a mushroom, as we'll need some extra speed for this next trick to work. We wait for another driver to get into the correct position, and then we boost into them, which allows us to get a huge amount of height. With all of this height and speed, we can clear the mountain wall nearby and land out of bounds. Lakitu then places us back on the track just before the finish line, and we complete the race. With our understanding of how the finish line works, this shortcut should be easy to understand. The jump got us behind the wall, which is where the finish line ends. It was vitally important, however, that when we cleared the wall, we were still in front of the finish line. But once we were beyond the wall, the direction we were going put us slightly behind the finish line before we landed out of bounds. When Lakitu decides where to put us back on the track, it will always look for the closest section. In this case, it's technically the tunnel, but Lakitu will never place us there, so the next best thing is the section we just came from. It's basically the same concept as the Wario Stadium shortcut we looked at before, but this is obviously much more complex. This strategy of boosting off of another driver is way too precise to ever be performed by a human. But even if it were, this doesn't help us in time trials, which is where all of the course records are set. In time trials, there are no other drivers, and no items. The wall we'd have to jump over is much too high, so the idea of clearing this wall in order to go around the finish line seems impossible. This is why in 25 years, the best anyone could come up with for a shortcut on this level is a hellish 1 in 90,000 fence clip. But as it turns out, there is a mechanic that makes it possible to clear this wall. And in late 2020, the TAS masters Drew Weatherton and Forrest 64 would crack the code of a mechanic called the Ultra Bounce. In the past 1.5 years, Mario Kart 64 has been turned upside down by a ton of new shortcut discoveries. Almost every track has been utterly revamped, and many of the current records are now hilariously low. One of the bigger discoveries was the realization that you could drive through walls on specific corners. The YouTuber Bismuth has a very detailed video on this mechanic that you can watch if you want to know more. The wall on Kalimuri Desert seemed to be too high to even consider jumping over, but there might have been a chance to achieve the same goal if you could drive straight through it. Using cheats, the TASer Drew Weatherton showed a proof of concept demonstrating that it would work if you could get through the wall. Weatherton tried various angles and ultimately couldn't get it to work. This wall just doesn't meet the requirements necessary to allow the player to get through. But he did notice something interesting. When he made contact with the wall, he would sometimes get a very noticeable bounce upwards. When combined with the jump button, he would get a ton of height, possibly enough to even clear the wall. This type of jump had been seen before. For over 20 years, the strategy for the very first track, Luigi's Raceway, involved jumping over a wall with a similar bounce. This wall is significantly shorter though, making it much easier to clear. Another large jump was the old shortcut strategy for Calimari Desert. This is where players would jump off of a small bump in the terrain to get over the tracks. The height that you could get off these types of jumps doesn't really make sense, and for the longest time, it wasn't even understood what was happening. In late 2020, Weatherturn and Forest 64 decided to finally unravel the mystery of these large jumps, and through trial and error, they discovered a new mechanic that was built into the game. I'll let Weatherturn himself explain how it works.
As with any video game, Mario Kart 64 has frames that you interact with, and this game runs at
60 physics frames per second.
As you approach the ground in a fall, it may be that you have a frame that happens to come very close to the ground, and thus you come to rest on the ground. But it could also be that you're moving fast enough, or you had a certain starting height that made it happen. You end up pretty far below the ground on one of these frames. And if you're at least 1.7 units into the ground, there's a mechanic built in the game that ejects you on the ground. And it's also true that if you happen to press R to jump on that frame where you're in the ground, you get ejected even further. And that's true on flat ground. It's also true on angled ground. So you can drive into a slope, get far enough under the ground that you can get a bounce in that way as well. You can also fall at an angle. So there's a lot of different options of how to get these bounces.
So that explains the why, but finding a way to actually apply it to Calimari Desert is a whole different ballgame. In order to run some tests, Weatherturn went into 150cc Grand Prix and used a star. This gives the fastest possible speed, so if it couldn't work here, it's essentially out of the question entirely. He showed that it was possible to get over the wall. The only problem now is making it work in time trials. Weatherturn did try various angles and methods, but he ultimately couldn't do it. But he did come pretty close. In July of 2021, he released a video explaining how the Ultra Bounce worked and included his efforts on Calimari Desert. Given that he was so close, this inspired a few people to try it themselves. One of them was fellow Tasser, Forest 64, who did manage to figure out a way to get over the wall 2 days later on the 27th of July. This was found and performed using tools, so it wasn't legit. The setup he came up with was extremely impractical and never really had any chance of being something a person could implement. It was definitely a good first step though, to show that not only could you get over the wall, but you could also do it in a way that allows you to successfully circumvent the finish line. Another person that was trying to find a way over the wall was none other than Mr. Pitt, who, if you recall, was the player that infamously got the fence clip and immediately paused. Mr. Pitt felt that this new strategy was his chance at redemption, a way to wash away his previous sin and finally claim that elusive world record. Mr. Pitt had no real clue what he was doing, but he was fearless and determined. Sometimes the desire to succeed is all you need. Mr. Pitt would never make it over the wall, but he did come surprisingly close, and most importantly, he was doing it in a way that was much more realistic. He showed that even with a basic setup, a ton of height could still be generated. The problem with this strategy is that it has to be really precise. The game won't tell you where to jump, where to land, or which angle you should use. All of these variables need to be discovered through trial and error. Even if the strategy were possible, there is still a very good chance that a reasonable way to do it would never be found. Mr. Pitt's valiant efforts did inspire Forest 64 to re-examine the setup though, taking a more straight-on approach. And seemingly by sheer luck, he stumbled upon the perfect setup. One that was both relatively easy and also extremely fast. This looks much simpler than it really is. There is a ton going on here for this to work. Let's break it down. First, we get into our starting position, which should be the same each time. This is important because of something called frame spacing. given that our goal is to embed ourselves into the slope enough for the game to push us out and cause the ultra bounce, our position on each frame needs to be very specific. We want the previous frame to occur as close to the wall as possible. This gives us the full frame to get as deep as we can. This should go without saying, but we aim for a very specific spot on the wall, which is helped by the fairly obvious textures. Before we take off, we get into what's called an A-B turn state. When the cart is stationary and you press and hold A and B at the same time, you can turn very quickly. If you hold A and B and then start moving with a boost, you can retain this ability to turn sharper, which we will need. We then activate a mushroom to propel ourselves forward. At the crest of this small mound, we start turning left and jump. This first jump is important because we need to come down and hit the next slope at the best possible angle. This next moment is where everything comes together. We need to land perfectly in the corner of the slope and the vertical wall, hitting both at the same time. Hitting the slope is what gives us the ultra bounce, which we need to clear the wall. But the reason for hitting the wall itself is less obvious. Given that we just jumped from the previous mound, technically we shouldn't be able to jump again to initiate the ultra bounce. This is because the game has a flag that knows if you're in the air due to a jump or not. If you did leave the ground because of a jump, you can't jump again until the flag resets. And you'll need to hit the ground for at least a full frame before that happens. But this is too long to wait, because the ultra bounce requires you to jump on the exact same frame that you land inside of the ground. However, hitting walls also resets the jump flag, and for technical reasons, even if you hit the wall on the same frame, it still allows you to instantly jump again. Long story short, you need to land perfectly in the corner touching both the wall and the slope, plus press jump on the exact same frame, plus embed yourself sufficiently deep enough into the slope, and if everything comes together, you'll be able to pull off an ultra bounce high enough to clear the wall. It's around here that we also cross and get ahead of the finish line. If your angle of attack and turning speed is correct, once you're over the wall, you can cover enough distance to land out of bounds back behind the finish line. When I first saw this jump, I was shocked that it wasn't found sooner, because it really does look simple. But when you understand how many pieces have to fit together to make this happen, it's actually kind of shocking that it was found at all. What's even more shocking is how easy this new strategy turned out to be. Within a day of Forest 64 posting the task for this human viable setup, multiple runners had repeated it. The first being iMath.
We have the like the metal to.
Oh, I made it over.
Wait, it might have actually worked.
Holy shit, come on.
Don't spin out.
Yes, let's go! Dossie is dead! Dossie is fucking dead! Holy shit.
Are you serious?
I just got Desert Tanko! Desert fucking Tanko!
Let's clip.
iMath's first completed run beat Dossie's record with the fence clip by a full 10 seconds. This was performed using the shortcut a single time, but the goal would be to perform it on all three laps. Later that same day, iMath would be the first to perform the jump for 2 out of 3 laps, bringing the time down another 20 seconds.
So we're going to lap 2. Oh my god, 2 for 3! Let's go! Oh my god, let's go! Holy shit! Oh my god, I actually did it!
Given how quickly 2 out of 3 was achieved, it was pretty clear that 3 out of 3 would be coming shortly. In fact, iMath came very close to doing it on the first day.
Here we go. No, dude, that was really? I got that close? Dude.
But it wouldn't be until the next day that the runner Martin K became the first to do so. For the next week, it was a back and forth battle between Martin K and Beck Abney, each claiming the 3-lap world record multiple times. For the moment, Martin K holds the current world record with a time of 38.9 seconds, which is just shy of a full minute faster than the fence clip record set by Dossie earlier in the year. There is still definitely time left to be saved on this level, and most of that time will be in the setup of the trick itself. You can still see a bit of hesitation between getting into position and initiating the boost, and as time goes on, this should be reduced. And who knows, maybe an even faster setup will be found. There is so much going on in the world of Mario Kart 64 right now, and I have it on good authority there might even be more major breakthroughs coming in the future. If you like Mario Kart content, let me know in the comments and I might cover more of these crazy shortcuts. Big thanks to Drew Retherton and Forest64 for teaching me about their new discovery. I will put a link to Drew's video outlining a bit more about the Ultra Bounce in the description. As always, thank you so much for watching, you legends. I hope you are having a fantastic day, and I will see you in the next video.